Okay, well, it's 5 minutes after. We're gonna go ahead and get started. So, what I've got going on is today we're gonna honor military working dog Coba. Military working dog is MWD, and what they do is they military working dog Coba actually was a tactical explosive detection dog. So she worked over in Afghanistan for several years to actually find bombs so that our military men and women wouldn't find them. So I'm going to actually draw her today. And then I'm also going to kind of talk a little bit about another initiative that I have going on, which is I'm wanting to honor service and working animals. And so what that means is any animal that serves a human, whether it be an MWD, military working dog, a contract working dog, which is CWD, and the first one I did for that one was actually Nero, who was having a memorial today. So if you want to participate in this sort of thing, I would greatly appreciate it. I actually have a GoFundMe page now. It's gofundme.com/artforpaws. So art for paws again, that's FUR. Get it? Art for paws. Okay. So art for paws, and I actually rebranded everything that I've been having over the last several years. I've been blogging for about 5 years, and before that I was grinning like an idiot because I'm always smiling. And so I rebranded everything because now I have a purpose, and that purpose really started last October when I read about CWD, contract working dog Nero, and I read about him through Mission Canine Rescue. And when I saw just the everything that this dog had done, and here he is in a coffin with a flag laid across him, and I immediately went, "Holy crap!" And I woke up my husband. I was like, "Holy crap! Somebody's got to do something to honor these animals." And I finally had a purpose. So I was really excited and torn up about it because something had to be done. Somebody needs to do something. And there, I've been digging deeper into all of this, contract working dogs, military working dogs, into the animal therapy dogs, and even there's animal therapy horses that help the little miniature horses. I mean, how stinking cute is that? And those help blind people. So there's all sorts of things and animals out there. And as part of this, I'm looking at all of these things that these animals are doing. And at the same time, on Facebook, you'll see all this stuff about animal cruelty. And it's just not right. We need, as a society, to do something more for the animals that are serving us. So I'm starting this initiative now so that I can build up effectively a memorial wall on my Art for Paws website. And once you see all of these beautiful animals that help us as a society, help us, my then next thing I want to see happen is let's start protecting them. We're not doing enough at all. And so I know I've kind of got large ambitions for this, and I started with Nero. He was my number one dog. And Nero is actually have a memorial today. I know I mentioned that before, but he served 7 years in Afghanistan and came back to the States and had several medical issues. And a lot of these contract and military dogs have medical issues. And even the humans, if they're over in Afghanistan for a long period of time, they are going to have issues because of all the toxins that are in the air and in the ground that due to the infernos and everything that they're burning stuff all the time. So these military and contractor working dogs are coming back with health issues. And when they come back with health issues, we have groups like Mission Canine Rescue and loving caring people like Judy who put a lot of money and care, a lot of care, into these animals to get them to a family where they can retire and be cared for. So, where am I going with all this? So, obviously, they kind of really have my heart, and you know, I've got two dogs myself. They're both rescue animals, and you know, if you have an animal, you know that they have a soul. You can see it in their eyes, and if you've ever seen one go to heaven, you know they have a soul. So, on that note, how can you help? Go to www.gofundme.com/artforpaws, and I have a lot of different offerings. So if you donate, like, I think it was like $15, $20, I forget what it is. But if you donate like a certain level, I'm going to give you a gift, because what you are doing is helping other people, you know, honor the ones that they loved, and these fur babies that they loved. So I really hope that you take part in this, and I would love to send you a gift. I'd love to actually see you sponsor an animal, and tell me about an animal. If you know somebody that owns a service or a working animal, whether it be, you know, I've heard about ferrets can help with seizures. I even read a story about a boa constrictor that this guy wore around his neck to keep track of seizures and such. So, I mean, it's unreal what can actually happen here. So if you know of a story of somebody that has a service or working dog, go to www.artfurpaws, that's art, then F-U-R, paws, P-A-W-S.com, and there's a little nomination. Just fill out that form, and, you know, if you want to donate, of course, I would love that too. So, the next thing I'd like for you guys to do before we get started, and I'm going to show you guys some pictures of what a dry brush oil looks like. So I'm hoping for a little more participation. So for the next 2 minutes, just 2 minutes, if you guys could put in here somebody's name you think might be interested in watching this video or learning a little bit about this initiative. So if those people join, then I'm going to give you a print of Military Working Dog, MWD, Coba, that I'll be painting today. So go ahead and ping those people, and let's see if we can get some more participation. And thank you all so much. I'm loving all the smiley faces and the hearts and, you know, thumbs up. And Jennifer, thank you so much for telling me thank you. You rock. So it's getting more comfortable now. I was like so nervous before all of this. So now once I get started talking, I'm kind of good. The butterflies are out. And once I start painting, you're going to find that I'm kind of zen again. So so just come on in and ask me any questions. I am good with that. I've got my computer up to the left of me, and so I can watch the comments kind of come in. And thank you, Louisa, for inviting Peggy. I hope Peggy comes. Jennifer, thank you for inviting Dakota. I hope she comes. That'd be awesome. So, and I'm going to take notes over here. My desk is actually, it's huge, but it's one of those things, I've got stuff all over it. I mean, seriously, I've got, what is this thing, an iPhone with a little camera stand. I've got my iPad has all the pictures and stuff that I use. I always paint from pictures, unless it's like a still life or I'm doing something kind of to train. Peggy, you're here. That's awesome. Okay. So I know, let's see, who pinged Peggy? Let's see. Oh, you guys are awesome. Okay. This is awesome. Thank you guys so much for all your support. This is so exciting. Oh, Lane Beersley. Thank you for pinging Carson and Tammy. So hopefully we can get a lot of participation. Because I'm looking at you guys to really kind of bring this in and help spread the word, because it's just me right now. Well, and I also have another guy, his name is Alex, and he works down at Redstone Arsenal with me, and every Wednesday I go down there to paint, and he is, he does all of the framing of the pet portraits and the things that we're doing. I'm just watching all these comments come up. I'm like, okay, it's so distracting, but it's awesome. But yeah, it's he's also helping support and do a lot of things. And we've been doing this stuff for free because it's the right thing to do. Like I said, it's one of those things where somebody has to do something. And, you know, I posted a quote the other day. I think it was Steve Jobs that said something to the effect of, people who you think people might be crazy, but those crazy people could actually do something like that. I can probably find it, but check out my Art for Paws website. It's got those quotes on it. I try and do like a little picture of one of my dogs that I paint and put some inspirational quotes, because I think we find a lot of inspiration in our animals and a lot of positive activity. Louisa, I think you're my biggest commenter. Thank you so much. Okay, so I think at this point I'm going to go ahead and you guys keep pinging people, bring them in. I really appreciate it. So I'm going to actually flip this thing around and start painting Coba. Oh, cool. Thanks, Brian, Bob. So, yeah, as you guys can see, there's lots of dogs out there. I mean, I'm on like several Facebook groups, and I'm just seeing all these dogs, and they've been passing away since 9/11 happened, and even before then. I mean, there's dogs back into Vietnam times, and we need to do something. It's just amazing. Oh, thank you. The people who are crazy enough to think they can change the world are the ones who do. And that is what I'm trying to do. So I know I'm acting a little bit crazy, but it's important. You got to start somewhere, right? So here we go. I'm going to flip you guys over so you can start watching the live feed here. Watch me start doing paintings. Okay, one second. Gotta remember how to do this. Okay. Alright, there's all the behind the scenes big old mess kind of going on there. Okay, let me kind of get things settled here so you can see kind of what's going on. There we go. Alright, so this is dry brush oil, and so these are a couple of examples that I did for this one. I did as a gift. His name is Titus. Titus passed away last year, and his owners actually had me paint several paintings of Titus, and he's gonna actually have me paint a couple more. So it's a good dog. So that's dry brush oil, and this one was a sample that I did for. It's a 5x7. There's a company that I work with called Patty Cakes and Patty Paws, and so what they'll do is they'll actually take these dry brush oil paintings and put them into a little frame and then have the dog's paw print next to it in a nice shadow box. It's really cool. And that's Patty Paws, Patty Cakes. You can check for artforpaws.com. I wrote a little article about them. They're pretty cool. Good people, locally owned and all that. Okay, so what you see here is CWD. I'm sorry, I keep doing that, Louisa. This is MWD, Military Working Dog. On my website, I also put up, like if you click on an article over to the right-hand side, you'll see that I started adding definitions of MWD versus CWD. And it's actually pretty fascinating and disappointing of how to see our working dogs and our being handled. So anyway, I'll get more into that. And as I build the wall of memorial portraits, I'm going to associate their stories with each one of those. Okay. Just ping me if there's any questions. Let's see. I'm going to go over here real quick. People who are crazy, that would be me. Okay. Taji isn't an MWD. Is he a CWD? See? Taking notes here. Okay. my husband was going to help me with this, and so I could focus on painting while the comments came in, and he said I would last like 5 minutes at that. But he said, I support you in everything that you do, but oh, I can't watch you paint. Alright, so this is what I'm using. This is lamp black water mixable oil color. So you can actually use oil paint as well, But I'm using water mixable oil color because it's easy cleanup. The station that I'm sitting at in my studio is a acrylic station that I use, and so everything over here is water-based, and I've got another section in my studio that's oil-based. It's because I do oil portraits, I do dry brush oil, and I do acrylic paintings. But this is lamp black water mixable oil, and what I have here, this is just a little canvas pad, and the canvas pad, I just put a little dollop. The dollop goes a long way. And then what's really interesting about this technique is the substance that we use. So this is actually sewing machine oil. And you don't necessarily have to get just sewing machine oil. The main ingredient is petroleum. So I can go to... thanks, Louisa. So I can actually go to the AutoZone or something like that and pick up petroleum oil. It's nice and cheap. It only takes like a couple drops. Okay. And then I mix it up. What the petroleum oil does is essentially kind of dries out all any oils that are already in there, especially for oil paint. It gets out the linseed oil. Okay, so I'm going to put that to the side. Okay, the brushes that I'm using, they're really just kind of the El Cheapo brushes here. I can get them at they're craft brushes pretty much. I do not use my oil brushes. These are synthetic. And look at that, I already managed to get paint on me. I'm good like that. Okay, so these are cheap, and this one is actually a fabric brush. It's great for scrubbing. It's extremely stiff. So, all right, those are those. The paper that I'm using, it is this kind of paper. It's Bristol, and it's 100-pound paper, and I'm actually using a 9x12, and I've taped off using painter's tape sections that I don't want to paint on because this is going to go into an 8x10 type frame, but I want to keep the sides clean so you don't have any all the subjects in here. Do I do this for anyone? How much do you charge? So if you want, you can actually, I do this for anyone. I do custom oil portraits. I do pop art. If you want to take a look at my website, www.artfurpaws.com, I have a price and processing list there. And if you want to ping me, private message me, I'll be glad to talk with you and see any pictures that you have. And, okay, so I just loaded up my brush just a little bit and I wiped a majority of it off. Because this is dry brush. So I just kind of go in, and I have to go very lightly to begin with, because about the only negative thing about dry brush oil is that if you screw up, you pretty much have to start over. So the key is to stay light and build the layer of darkness so that I can easily erase. And how I erase is these little kneadable eraser. I've got a nice assortment of erasers. And there's nothing special really about each one. It's just find an eraser that you like and go with it. Just see a random hair on it. I typically start with the eyes, and you'll notice I'm leaving the whites, like the really reflective light. I'm going to leave that open. And like I said, I've got my iPad over to the side, so I'm constantly referencing the original photo. actually, if you guys live or in the Huntsville area, I am going to be demonstrating this also at the Greater Huntsville Humane Society Dog Ball on February 3rd. If you plan on going, I hope to see you there. And when I was practicing this on my personal page, you know, doing the live feed and all that, I'll say it again. I got to give props to Bob Ross for being able to talk and paint at the same time. I'm just going to turn this a little bit to work on it a little better. And I keep my hand on paper because sometimes I get my hand in this stuff and I really don't want to get it on the painting. Eye is starting to come to life. This is why I use the cheap brushes, because I'm really in here and I'm going to scrub this in. This technique is a lot like graphite pencils, except you would use blending stumps a lot, whereas I just use my brush to create the texture that I want and the fur. Try and go in the direction of the fur. So you notice I'm going back over a darker layer so I can start getting the shadows of Coba's face. Okay. I've been painting for probably about 15 years, And before I started painting, well, as a professional artist, I guess, I managed a team of project managers for a large software implementation company. And when my husband was deployed to Afghanistan, we decided that it'd be better if I just stayed home with the kids and focus on family while he was away. And shoot, I tell you what, I did not want to go back. And so we decided, well, didn't need to. And it was during his deployment that I kind of got back into art and, you know, because the kids were in school. They're now, what are they? They're 8 and 10. At the time, they were 5 and 7. And so she was just going off to kindergarten, and he was in second grade. Yeah, I think that's about right. And so I had time on my hands. And so I got back into painting, and I started getting into helping some rescue organizations locally and working with them and donating any 10% to like Greater Huntsville Humane Society and painting some portraits for them whenever they had like a long-term animal, just to help raise awareness about the animal and show them a different light. It's really kind of hard to see, you know, the animals when they are locked in cages, that, you know, they do have a happy side. Sometimes the animals get so distressed. And so that's kind of how I got to helping with the Greater Huntsville Humane Society. And just was it last week? I think it was last week. Maybe the week before. I hung about 14 paintings and prints in Flint River Animal Hospital here in Huntsville. And so if they sell any, then I'm going to, or if I get any commissions from them, I'm going to give 10% to their Circle of Angels organization. And the Circle of Angels, what they help do is, you know, any animal that's found, they'll spay and neuter them or give them whatever care that they need. So, and it's pretty much just one person kind of running that too, and her name is, you know, Tammy. And so this will help her out and the animals out. I believe in giving back to society. I think God gave me something of a gift here, and it's my purpose to find a way to give it back to the world, and hope that it helps. So my plan with, you know, if any commissions come from, you know, this, where it's not necessarily a working dog, but somebody wants me to paint their portrait for themselves or for a loved one. This Christmas was huge this past year. I think I did about 30 commissions for Christmas presents. And so if anybody wants me to do one of those and they hear from me, either from Mission Canine Rescue or Greater Huntsville Humane Society or Arts for Paws or even one of these things, I always give 10% back to whichever organization helped me. Okay, just gonna, like I said before, I give props to Rob Ross for talking during this. Okay. Because again, I'm constantly referencing the picture that's up in front of me of Coba. MWD Coba, military working dog. And let's see, here's his muzzle. Okay. Is he starting to look? Yeah, he's coming.
It really does help actually having a video camera up, because when you paint, you're supposed to actually walk away and come back, and so you can see it at a distance. And I don't often do that. The other day when I was painting this for practice, I actually painted Coba with her owner, Louisa. And I was on the live meeting for 2 hours. I don't think this is going to take 2 hours, but I lose track of time when I'm painting. And that was one thing that my husband was going to do, is like, hey, you know, I'm getting bored over here. What are you going to do? Some type of thing. Right now, I'm really just getting in that first layer of paint so I can really get some depth in a minute. So when I do get a nomination for a service and working animal, like I said, I'm going to ask, I'd like to actually meet with the owner and learn more about the personality, because whenever I do pet portraits, I like to know their story. And as I said before, their story, I'm going to publish it on my website so that we can start building a wall of memorials that tell these, you know, amazing animal stories, and with the idea that I want better regulations, and I want better regulations and on how animals are treated, because right now, as I said, we're really failing them, and I think. Well, I know my animals are really, really lucky and spoiled rotten and a little bit too fat, but I think that's also has to do with the food. There needs to be food and FDA regulations so that they're not going to get fed all the diseased meat that's coming from China and all these other places. It's just crap food. Just kind of checking where I'm at. As I said earlier on, if you ping somebody and they join, I'm going to give you a portrait, a print of MWD Coba here when I finish it. I may not finish it during the live meeting today, because I think if you guys hung on like for that long, you're probably kind of bored. I don't know. I personally get fascinated by these things. I remember when I was younger, I would watch Bob Ross paint, and I swear I was just sitting there catching flies with my mouth hung open, just in awe of what the guy could do. He paints a wet-on-wet style, and the style that I paint is actually, it's called traditional. It's kind of how the Renaissance era they painted when I do traditional oil portraits. This dry brush oil method is something that's not very common in the States. It's more common in like the Ukraine and Russia and those areas. I'm not sure why. And this method is, it's fast, it's fun, it's cheap. And I love the results. I mean, I cannot wait. Well, I kind of can wait, but I can't wait to see, you know, all the portraits up on one wall, and it's just going to be mesmerizing. I like the black and white portraits. They just really speak, and to me. I went to Auschwitz when I was in grad school, and seeing all the portraits of the ones who went through Auschwitz, because for some reason they took their picture, and after they shaved their heads, and you just saw the expressions in their eyes, and I think this dry brush oil and black and white method just really just captures that emotion in their eyes. So when I look at like Nero's portrait, I wanted to capture the light and happiness that was in his eyes. And I think Coba here, she's got such sweet and just loving eyes. You can see it. Sandy, you're cracking me up. Okay. Sandy's on the comment. She just made a comment that Alex and her are watching my nails. Like I told you guys earlier, Alex is the guy at Redstone Arsenal who I paint with on a weekly basis. And he's the one that's doing all the professional framing and matting of these pieces. And he's... I visited with them earlier today because I got my nails done. It's the first time I've gotten my nails done in like, I don't know, 3 years, because I just don't do it. And I got it done because I knew you guys would be staring at my nails and painting, and I didn't want to be all that self-conscious about it. Yeah, I always depend on Alex for giving me crap. Like I said, I've been blogging for like 5 years, and every time I see like through this Instagram post from the food blogger friends and the travel blogger friends, their nails are always done. And I was more of a craft blogger, and so like a craft and, you know, building and type of blogger, and so my nails were always just atrocious. And and these are real, they're mine, they're just, you know, gel, shellac or whatever. So if you guys, one thing I was going to ask is, like, how did you find out about me? I feel like I've been advertising all over the place about this to try and get some participation. And I'm going to start doing this live for future portraits because just to help raise awareness about these awesome animals that time should not forget. You know, we need to honor them. So if you don't mind, post into in the comments section how you heard about me. You know, whether it's from Louisa or Mission Canine Rescue, I've been posting on like War Dog Facebook page. I've been posting anywhere and everywhere that, and some of my art pages that I follow. I'd love to see how you guys heard about me. So if this goes past 8:30, I don't know. What do you guys want me to do? You want me to keep going so you can see like the final product? Because I don't go over like 2 hours doing these things, I don't think. So I'll leave that up to you. You tell me what you want me to do. As I said earlier, if you know somebody who needs to be nominated, like their service or working animal, go to www.artforpaws.com. That's F-U-R, paws, P-A-W-S. And enter, there's a nomination drop-down menu, and you can fill out the form. And that gets me a little bit of information about their story and your contact information so I can get you on the list and get some funding started for it. What else can I tell you guys? I think Louisa is my biggest advertiser. Thanks, Louisa. I'm hoping to. I submitted some information to Rick and Bubba Show. That's a place here in Alabama. They're like a Christian-based radio station guys, and they're just funny. I was hoping to get on there to get the word out about this. Like I said, I've got big dreams about this, to get it to make some changes and to some laws. Let's see here. If you guys just joined, I really hope that you go to the beginning of this live event, and I'll actually record it and put it on my Facebook page. Not my Facebook page. It'll already be on the Facebook page, but also my YouTube, and then I'm going to write an article about it on my Art for Paws, so that I know I've got a lot of email subscribers who aren't on today, who are interested. I've got some YouTube followers that when I do YouTube, a lot of times it is like a how-to paint, and like we've painted cupcakes, we've painted pancakes, we've painted I don't know, a whole bunch of things like that. And but if this little Facebook Live goes off well, I mean, I'm thinking about doing some like painting sessions this way, and that way I don't really have to edit and record. Because I could paint something like a cupcake in about 45 minutes, and then it takes me like 3-4 hours just to edit the darn thing and get it to a speed that's, you know, doable and reasonable for YouTube. Well, with this is awesome. All I have to do is hit play and go. But the bad thing is you guys kind of hear me rambling all the time. I can't edit all this stuff out. The one major worry that I had about this whole thing was my internet provider. I really have not too much positive things to say about them. I was really worried that my internet would go down or something like that. Thanks, Jennifer. I didn't start painting until I was, let's see, I guess I was about 26. It was just one of those things that I kind of thought if I could just find a teacher, I might be good at this. And when my husband and I first got a house, I went to go looking for paintings to put on the walls. And people were charging like $200 or something for, you know, just like a swish across the painting, the canvas. And I thought, well, surely I could do something like that. And it took me a while, but I found a teacher. And after that, she just kind of turned me loose. And she showed me the basics, and then she actually retired and moved to Florida, and then I started painting with Shane McDonald in Atlanta, Georgia. That's when we lived in Atlanta, and there, I gotta get rid of that hair. And he taught me a ton, and it's just been, and since then, you know, now we got YouTube, and we've got Pinterest. And actually, Pinterest is how I found out about this dry brush oil technique. And I just thought, oh my God, that's gorgeous. I got to figure out how to do that. And I watched some guy's video in Russia and read his website. And I just sat down one night and started trying to figure it out. And I started painting people's kids and pets, whether they wanted me to or not, just to practice. And I do that a lot, actually. I'll ask for muses because I try and paint almost every day and draw so I can get better and better. Because I'm only 41, and I figure by the time I'm like 80, that should be awesome. And ahead. I'm trying to think what else I can tell you guys. So, let's see. Why don't you guys ask me a question? Keep it interactive. one thing I forgot to tell you. So when I draw these, I'm actually using a pencil. It's called Polychromos. What's this one right here? Faber-Castell Polychromos. It's a oil-based pencil. So when I use these paints, it makes all the lines go away. That's one thing that I don't think anybody really knew about, because I think that Russian guy and a couple of the Ukrainian people that I've watched do this, they all use just graphite, and so they end up having to erase, and that messes with their paintings. I don't know where you can see, but and I found out about polychromos by watching other YouTube videos and stuff. There's, you can just constantly learn with everything. My kids asked me once, what would you do if you died tomorrow? You know, kids, 8 and 10, they ask a lot of questions like that. And my response is, well, I can't die tomorrow. I've got too much to do. So I think that just applies for everything. I got too much to do. I think I got a purpose in this life. Got to make sure those kids grow up and be responsible adults. And now I've got this mission where I want to make these dogs known and remembered, and their stories remembered. And I got his nose slightly off here. Fix that. And I think as you see these stories build, you're going to start seeing a common thread among the CWDs and MWDs. And that's something that we all need to change to. I got a friend of mine a guy that I'm doing a cat portrait for, and he wrote a book about his cat, Mighty Little Man. And I haven't gotten to the section in the book yet, but he talks about how in the Bible it actually talks about how animals have souls. And so it goes back to Genesis. I haven't actually read it, gotten that far yet. It's a kind of cool book, Mighty Little Man, if you guys have a chance to pick it up on Kindle. It's pretty good. It's like a compilation of all these stories. He was a military man too, actually. I think he still is. And the cat was a Navy mascot, so the cat's got quite a story. Okay, that nose is looking, I gotta show you guys some point the first pet portrait I ever did. It was of my dog, Peanut. She was a Jack Russell. Your typical Jack Russell, you know, throw the ball, constantly jumping up and down. And, I painted her, and it was my first one. And it, I tell you, that nose, I like to die trying to figure out how to paint that nose. I still struggle on some things, like Mighty Little Man. He's got, one eye, he had an infection in his eye when he was about 3 years old, I think. And so it's squinty. So one eye is squinty. And when I paint, a lot of times I just want that symmetrical, you know, the everything's perfect on one side, the other side has got to be perfect too. And man, that eye has given me fits. But he's a cool cat. He's just... Just got to remember that when you're painting, that you're painting values. So like this is values, lights and darks. And that's what I got to remember the whole time. I'm not actually painting a nose, I'm painting a dark section. And that really helps. There's a whole book about that, drawing on the right side of your brain. I read a lot. let's see, can you do this with colors rather than just black? I can, and actually one of my favorite colors to probably do this with is, I like the, let's see, the one that I'm using now is lamp black. If I use ivory black, it gets a sepia tone, and that's really pretty and elegant. I've messed with it in ultramarine blue, which is a deep kind of blue, almost purple. And that's pretty cool too. I used to do a lot of pencil drawings in that those colors because it was just so pretty. I haven't done this where I'm trying to make it like realistic face colors. Like I've done this with people, and I don't like it. If I'm gonna paint a full portrait in color, I'd rather just go straight up traditional oil, because it's traditional oil is gorgeous too. I think this is when you want an emotional attachment that you do like monochromatic. Does that make sense? I mean, black and white is just really emotional. Remember when Ben and I got married, I specifically asked for black and white portraits, and I did not get any of them. The photographer, nobody listened to me when I was getting married. I didn't get anything I wanted, except for my husband. He was awesome, and that's why you get married. So when I'm doing these portraits, I got to keep in mind like a hard edge and a soft edge. Oh man, I already got paint all over me. But a hard edge and a soft edge. And what that does is it helps give a three-dimensional look. And a hard edge is where you've got like a hard line like that. Soft edge is soft over here. And you kind of want to alternate them back and forth to get the three-dimensional look. The hard and soft edges also help you kind of direct where you want the viewer's eyes to go. So I may get his face finished in the next like 15 minutes for this evening. Just go back and add some layers. The nice thing about this water-soluble paint is even though my fingers are a disaster right now, it'll wash off with soap and water. before I started this little live Facebook thing, I was catching up on all the Facebook rhetoric about, oh, all the politics and stuff. And I was like, oh, gosh, this would be a great break for everybody. And what's not to like than watching that dog being painted? You know what I mean? Yeah, actually, before this painting of, you know, Coba here is a chocolate lab. I was actually debating whether to do this in a sepia tone or do my black and white here. So for those that just join, I kind of hope that you watch the beginning of the video too, because this is MWD Coba, and Coba passed away in November of last year. And I was saying in the beginning of the video, I really started becoming actively aware of our military and contracting working dogs when I came across Mission Canine Rescue's post about CWD Nero. Nero passed away in October, and it emotionally just floored me. I was a complete wreck, and it wasn't even my dog, but I was just a complete wreck after seeing the imagery on the website and reading the emotional this gut-wrenching story from his owner, and I just got to thinking something's got to be done to honor these amazing animals. And so I started with Nero, Coba here is my second, and I've got Reiki and Zorro, and I think you guys are going to nominate a few more. I hear Taji, and I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing Taji's name right, but I want to know about these animals and their stories so that we can create a memorial wall on, you know, a virtual memorial wall that's available to the world, and start doing more to protect not only, you know, service animals, but all animals. And I think the service animals are a good example of how these animals care for us, and it's our responsibility for them, for us to care for them. And as I said before, we're failing them as a society. So I'd like, you know, any support that you can give on my GoFundMe, what is it? GoFundMe.com/artforpaws. If you can go there, I do have gifts for like first 20 in each giving category. If you want to sponsor an animal, to sponsor one of these portraits, it costs us about $250, and the majority of that is like shipping, packaging, framing. I mean, the frames that Alex does and the matting, I mean, he doesn't look for money, and we've been doing this for free, and, you know, it just helps, because I don't want it to be a burden to anyone, and I want it to be where we honor these animals and the owners as a society, but at no cost to the owner, because they've already given so much. I mean, these, I'm having a hard time painting and really getting this across, but these owners of these animals, they know that they're going to have extensive medical payments for these animals, because when most of the CWDs and MWDs that come back, they've got cancer from all the toxins and stuff that they take in over there, or they've got emotional distress, PTSD. That's a real thing in dogs. They have to get on Prozac. You know, these things, and the owners know that it costs them money. But, and they just love them so much that one of the things that Judy told me, she's like, once you foster or care for one of these animals, you just want to keep doing it, because you get to see, she's, I'm kind of paraphrasing, but you get to see how little that they had, and you're able to give it all to them. Some of these dogs, you know, all they do is work, and when they get home, they don't even know how to play. They get a ball and they'll just take it to their crate and keep it because they're afraid it might get taken away. They don't know how to fetch, you know. They just want to play with what they have been given and then make sure that nobody can take it away. I mean, that's, and when the canine, you know, these rescue animals like the MWDs, CWDs, when you make a breakthrough and see that as and see that breakthrough, your heart is in it. And I just, phew, I don't want these people to have to pay for any of this. If Alex and I need to do it for free, we're going to do it for free. If I need to pay Alex, I will pay Alex. But again, whatever you can do, I appreciate, and I know you're helping others. And that's what we need to do. Well, Coba's coming along. I think I'm going to have a lot more work to do on her, but she's coming along very, very pretty. She's a pretty dog. go back up here and just kind of darken this one up a little bit. Change the structure of the eye just a little bit. This is one of those needleable erasers. It's just really good at picking up a little bit of graphite, or not graphite, this paint. When I was first kind of got started painting, one of the things I really liked to paint a lot was glass. And I think that really helped with how I do my eyes. Last year I actually created a video on how to paint eyes using oil paint. I haven't published it yet because I haven't edited it. So I'm kind of digging this Facebook stuff. That way I don't have to edit. But that also means that you guys kind of adore me chit-chatting. I don't know whether it's good or bad. We'll see. Anybody else have any questions? I don't mind answering. I tell you, I've been so excited and nervous about doing this. It was actually when I heard about it, October. I can tell you, I hee-hawed around about, what should I do? Should I do something? Da-da-da-da-da. Does anybody think this is worthwhile? And that, you know, just all those internal doubts. And I think it was just like, somebody's got to do something. And it just never left my mind. And now that I'm actually doing something, and I've talked with Louisa at Mission Canine Rescue, and I've talked with Judy, who owned Nero, and, you know, I've seen all these articles on Facebook, and, you know, yesterday, about those people in Turkey that cut off the dog's ear because it lost a fight. I mean, seriously, what is wrong with people? There needs to be punishment for all of this. There needs to be a database that captures this information so that, you know, those kids are messed up. They're going to be probably future serial killers. And we need to document it, find them, put them in jail. I mean, seriously, if somebody in jail is upset about pedophiles and all that, I wonder what they would do to a dog killer. Yeah, that makes me mad. So, obviously, I've got enough passion about it. I'm probably one of those crazy people Steve Jobs talked about. So I'm really hoping that, you know, together with a lot of support from you guys and long nights, and we can make a difference. That's my plan. Like I said, I hope by the time I'm 80, I'm going to be fabulous at this, and we can change the world. Gotta start somewhere. Aw, he's looking so cute. Thank you, Courtney. Oh, that's so nice. Usually I play music, but I found out that you can't do that with Facebook because copyright infringements and all that jazz. So every now and then it gets quiet. If you're wondering how I'm gonna do the whiskers, Coba's got a few little white ones kind of going out to the side over here. I actually use, here it is, it's a gel pen. And I'm just kind of drawing on there. And then I'll also go back in with like the polychromos here. Pull this up. And really add some definition. This is one reason I don't paint, I don't use a lot of pencils, because, man, these suckers wear out your fingers. You really got to press down on them. But just that little bit of touch there crisps up the eye. And the eye, to me, is the most important part of an animal. And as well as humans, because that's where you can really see the pain, the happiness, the sorrow. The joy, the surprise. This is where I make those, really define those hard edges versus the soft edges. And pencils help quite a bit with that. And try to move all around the painting, because if I get stuck in one spot for too long, I could totally obsess about that section. And instead, if I move to another section and work on the values in that one, then sometimes I see that I need to correct other values in the previous section. It's important not to get stuck in one single spot. Focus on the big picture and then work out the details. And I figure I'll, when I download this video, I'll put in fast forward mode too, so that, you know, people can see it going fast. I don't have to sit through the whole thing if they don't want to, but I'll record, you know, keep the intro, because I really want to stress, you know, the importance of memorializing these dogs and honoring their owners with a pet portrait that they can keep. Because I know I told Judy that one of the things that really just made me, like, ugly cry was thinking that, you know, whenever we lose one of our fur babies, we think about that last really hard decision of, you know, do we put them down? Do we let them suffer? Are they going to make it? You know, and that's always that last story that we tell. And I think it's important to remember the good times and capture the light in their eyes and the happiness and the love that they have in their eyes. And if you walk by that portrait every day and you go, oh God, there's my baby. And remember that look, the look of adoration, it's going to help with that healing process. I've painted every one of my animals. And I've got their bangs all throughout the house because they're... Like Frankie, he was my ragdoll cat. He only liked me. He didn't like any other cat. I mean, didn't like any other person. But he was the fluffiest thing you ever saw in your life. So you just couldn't want, you just wanted to pet him. And he didn't want anybody petting him. But I've got his portrait and actually hanging in our guest bathroom. And he's got that look on him like, what do you want? Why are you messing with me? I think if you go to my website, you can probably search for them. I think I named them, What Are You Looking At? Because it was just funny. That's just the look that he had. I had a cat named Louie. Louie, we named him that because of the explorers, and because when I first got him, brought him back from the animal shelter, he was just exploring everywhere, and that's why I named him Louie. Frankie, I named Frankie because of old blue eyes. He was a, you know, ragdoll. Ragdolls have blue eyes, and I thought that would be cool. Let's see, I gotta figure out what am I looking at here. Okay. Then we had Peanut, and she was the Jack Russell, and we thought she was my first painting. But we named her Peanut because when she slept, she looked like a peanut. And we got her. All she did was sleep. We thought we got it done because she didn't do anything. And but man, after like, I think she was, we got her when she was only like 8 weeks. And after another 2 weeks, man, there was no stopping that dog. She was just constantly threw the ball. Jumping up and down. She would, the little Jack Russell, and she would jump when you walk in the door. She would jump, kick off of your chest, lick you into the face, and it was just constantly that way. And she was a fun dog. She liked Ben better than me, but anyhow, can't please everybody. And then we had Charlie. He was a Cocker Spaniel. He had a really, oh, sorry. Yeah, I'll move it to the left. Thank you. Charlie had a really big head. Ben thought he looked like Baby New Year, but he had a big head. He was a Cocker Spaniel and incredibly, incredibly sweet. And I painted him next after Peanut. And that one was significantly better. I understood color theory a lot better. Let's see. Is that better? Let me see. Yeah, there we go. And let's see. And then I painted Sophie. Sophie is our Border Collie Australian Shepherd mix. Her we found at a campground. And she was just running around in the snow, cute as could be. And we found the people that owned her, at least what we thought with that owned her, and then it turns out they found her on the side of the road the previous day before and saved her. And they were going to give her away to one of his nephew. And so thankfully, you know, we met up with him the next day, and he said his nephew didn't want, the father of the nephew didn't want another dog, and so he said he'd give her to me. I was like, oh, heck yeah, I'll take her. So if you ever will go to my Facebook page or Instagram, you'll occasionally see me take pictures of Sophie. She sits on my desk as I do computer work and everything, and she'll like paw at me whenever it's her loving time. She also tells me every single time the UPS guy goes by, she just goes nuts. I don't know why she doesn't like that guy. And she tells me whenever the neighbors are home, she just looks out at the whole neighborhood. I probably should have called her the mayor or something. But she just keeps an eye on everything. And now we got Bacon. Bacon was we got him from Limestone County, Athens Animal Shelter. And his mother had like 10 puppies, and they didn't have that much room at the shelter. And so I pinged my husband. I was like, can I get it? And he told me, I'm not going to tell you no. So I was like, okay, good enough. And so I took off and went and got him. And, He came to the right family. He's got some hip dysplasia. He's let's see, how old is he? Yeah, he's a little over a year old now, and he's got significant like hip dysplasia, elbow dysplasia, and let's see, what else is wrong with that dog? He's got, he apparently broke his elbow at some point, and I don't know, but he's just such a sweet, sweet dog. He's a trip. And since we've been getting acupuncture on him, his hip dysplasia and the pain management has significantly gotten better. I mean, it's amazing. He's actually playing like a puppy now. And he'll actually chase a ball, and his jaws are so strong that he'll just rip the ball in half. I think he's a Border Collie, probably pit mix is what we're thinking. But he's awesome. Okay, bye, Sandy. Thanks for joining us. I know, what time is it? I'm supposed to go. My parents are watching my son and my daughter staying at a friend's house. And my husband's downstairs with the dog, so I could have this time with you guys without being interrupted. My daughter, she talks more than I do, so, you know, that tells you anything. I'll have to sign off here shortly too and go pick up my son. But he wanted to definitely go over to Grandma and Grandpa's. They got better Wi-Fi than what we have. So, and he's all into Minecraft and Oh, all these games that I'm just like, what? He's actually starting, he's considering starting a YouTube channel. Because apparently this whole watching people play video games is a big thing. I guess I do get it. Okay, so here I am painting. So yeah, I guess I do get it. If you really like doing something and you want to learn something from it, you watch a video. I totally do that all the time. Okay, so yeah, he wants to start a YouTube channel on video games. And I know there's a lot of them out there, but I figure why not. I found out the other day in my hot yoga class that there's a career in video games. So I'm like, well, okay. So it's not a total waste of time. I'll get behind him and support him. Now my daughter, she actually wants to be a veterinarian, which I am all gung-ho about. That would be amazing. I'd like for her to actually follow a veterinarian at some point so that she could see what they do. Because, I mean, it's not all fun and games. I know that. I don't know if she realizes that. Okay, let's see. This is part of his collar. These CWDs and MWD dogs have some serious collars going on. Oh, don't know if you can hear that. Dogs are going nuts. I don't know why. I think my son's being dropped off. Ready to come home. That's a good thing. They're good kids. Here comes one of them. Uh-oh. Ah, Ben took care of it. I've got awesome support in my family. You have no idea. I am extremely lucky to have the family that I have. Thank you, Courtney. That is incredibly sweet of you. I'm so glad you joined, and be on the lookout. I'm going to probably do, I think I'm supposed to do Reiki next. So I may start doing this maybe once a week, or every other week, and we'll have to figure out a schedule. Talk with my family, but I will definitely be doing this again, and maybe some other little demonstrations so you can get some girlfriends together and paint something, put it on pause, and stay home and paint instead of having to go someplace. paper towel. Figure out what this is. Part of his jacket, his vest. I mean, her vest. I keep doing that. You know the nice thing about these portraits, the dry brush oil, is you can put them behind glass. Traditional oil paintings, you can't do that. I like the nice matting and framing that you can do with dry brush oil. Yeah, he's looking good. She's looking good. I'm gonna soften up this because I don't want that to be the focus. thing about picking up this, you gotta clean it off every so often because it's picking up that paint and it dirties up your eraser. That way we can soften up some of these lines. Get some of those little grays in. A lot of these working dogs, contract working dogs, military working dogs, they come back after a couple years pretty gray. It's all the stress of the environment that they're in. We want to portray this amazing animal correctly. Little sprigs right up here. Let's see, right about there. And there. Blending it in a little bit because it's not that obvious. Call that done. Let me know what you guys think and feel free to leave comments. Feel free to, you know, spread the word about what I'm trying to do. And, you know, I really appreciate you guys hanging in here with me tonight. And I really hope you enjoyed the painting and the process and learning a little bit about these animals. And I hope you also go to my website, artforpaws.com. And sign up for my newsletter. I don't send out a lot of newsletters because I don't have time to spam. And I don't think anybody else has time to read a lot of stuff. So, but I would encourage you to go to artforpaws.com and keep up with what I'm doing and participate. I love, 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 love comments. I do read every single one of them. And yeah, just help spread the word. And I really appreciate it, and I think I'm about to sign this one. Okay. And you can't read my signature, but I will Also, I include a certificate of authenticity with the painting so that you kind of know who actually did it. And with Elisa, I am so glad you like it. It's been my pleasure painting Coba. And I'm still tinkering. There we go. Okay. Well, thank you guys. I hope you have a wonderful weekend. And if you have any questions, just private message. Feel free to message on this. I'd love to answer any questions that you may have. And until next time, keep a lookout on it on artforpaws.com, you know, Facebook / artforpaws. And I'll be doing more. Thank you guys so much. God bless.